Welcome to our online worship. My name's Jeremy James, one of the retired clergy on the team at St. Mary's, and it's my pleasure to be able to welcome you to our online worship and to say that whoever you are and wherever you're from, you are very welcome. We're continuing today our series of sermons in which we look through the big story told in the Bible from the book of Genesis right through to the book of Revelation. Last week, we reached the point in the story where Jesus came and fulfilled all the promises which we'd heard in earlier parts of the story. And today we ask, after Jesus' time, what next? A prayer as we begin. Father, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. We pray that it might be a lamp for our feet and a light for our path. Show us through that word of yours how we can play our part in the ongoing story of your good and loving purposes for the world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We have two readings, the first of them from Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one of them heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Our second reading comes from the end of St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, beginning at verse 16. The 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you to the very end of the age." There's an old legend, a rather twee old legend, about Jesus going back to heaven after his time on earth. Even in heaven, he still bore the marks of the cross. The angels were talking to him, and Gabriel said, "Master, you must have suffered terribly for the people down there." "I did suffer," said Jesus. "And," said Gabriel, "do they all know about how you loved them and what you did for them?" "No," said Jesus, "not yet. Just now, only a few people in Israel know." "What have you done to make sure that everyone knows?" asked Gabriel. Jesus said, "Well, I've asked Peter, James, and John, and a few others to make it the business of their lives to tell others about me. And then those others will tell still others, and then yet others, until people on the widest circle know what I've done. Gabriel looked doubtful because he knew what people were like. So what if Peter, James and John grow tired? What if the people who come after them forget? What if way down in the 21st century, people just don't tell others about you? Haven't you got any other plans? No, said Jesus, I haven't made any other plans. I'm counting on them. Over the last 5 weeks, we've been looking at the Bible's big story. We began with the picture painted for us of the Garden of Eden. Everything was perfect there until human sinfulness spoilt it. But in God's good grace, we heard that little hint of a promise. One day, there would come someone who would crush the head of the serpent, the source of evil. And then we heard the first part of God's plan to save the world from that sinfulness, and it was focused on one man, Abraham. God promised to bless Abraham, and he promised that through him and his descendants, all peoples on earth would be blessed. But as we continued the story, we heard how time after time, the descendants of Abraham either wandered away from God's good ways, or they chose completely to ignore God. But we heard too how God, through it all, remained faithful to them. He didn't give up on them. He didn't stop loving them. We heard how this was true through the period of the judges, through the period of the kings, and through the period when the prophets tried to persuade people to turn back to God, although their message often fell on deaf ears. And then last week we reached, at last, the climax of God's salvation story, the coming of Jesus, the one whom God had promised, the one for whom the people had been waiting for so long. Jesus, who through his sacrificial death and his glorious resurrection, truly brought God's salvation to the world. So is that it? Is the coming of Jesus the end of the story? No, because in God's good plan, Jesus came to a very particular part of the world at a very particular time in history. Now, the rest of the world, for the rest of time, needed to know about him too, so that they too could have the chance to take hold of the salvation which he made possible for us. Hence the message of that little legend with which I began. He's relying on us. And what we heard in our second reading was Jesus' great commission. Just before he left the earth, he said to his disciples, "Go and make disciples of all nations." That's our task as disciples of Jesus, to tell others about him so that they too can become his disciples. But in giving us that task, Jesus also promised that we'd have the help that we need in order to do it. After Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John wrote their Gospels, giving us their accounts of what Jesus did and what he said, one of them, Luke, wrote a second book. That's the book that we know as the Acts of the Apostles. Although some people have suggested that it should be called the Acts of the Holy Spirit, for reasons which will become very apparent in a moment. And right at the beginning of this book, Acts, Jesus says to his disciples, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in all Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." And then came Jesus' ascension. He left the earth. And so the next part in the Bible's big story is the part in which we are living. We've had 5 weeks of history. Now we've got to the present. This is the bit of the story where we feature. It's the period between Jesus' ascension and his return, the period often referred to as the age of the Spirit. So I want to spend a bit of time looking very quickly through this book, Acts, the book that tells us the story of the first years of the age of the Spirit, and so gives us lots of pointers as to how life will be for us as we continue that story. In our first reading from Acts chapter 2, we heard how the Holy Spirit came to the disciples on the day of Pentecost, and we heard an attempt to describe what it was like when it happened. It was like a violent wind blowing, and it was like tongues of fire. Now, the Holy Spirit didn't have to be accompanied by this sound and this sight. It didn't happen when the Holy Spirit came to other people whose stories are told in Acts. So we can assume that God caused the sound like the wind and the sight like fire for a particular purpose. And it was presumably to reassure the disciples as to what was happening. As Jewish people, the wind and the fire would immediately have made them think of God. The wind in the Old Testament was associated with God's power. God spoke to Job, for example, out of the whirlwind. And fire was associated with God's presence and with his holiness. In, for example, the burning bush or the pillar of fire in the book of Exodus. So when the believers on the day of Pentecost heard what sounded like a violent wind and saw what looked like tongues of fire, they would have been sure that in what was happening, there was God's power and God's presence. And the immediate effect of the Holy Spirit coming and bringing God's power and God's presence to them was that they went out onto the streets and spoke about God and about the Lord Jesus Christ. And this was a direct fulfillment of Jesus' promise in those final words of his to the disciples before his ascension, when he said, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses." And this really is what the whole book of Acts is all about, the Holy Spirit's involvement in the mission and witness of that early church. So let's have a look at three characteristics of the way he was involved in their mission. Three ways in which we might expect him to be involved in our mission, the mission of the church today, as we play our part in the Bible's continuing big story. So three things. And firstly, we see the Holy Spirit enabling the church in its mission. Now, this is particularly clear on the day of Pentecost itself, as the Holy Spirit came to all the believers in the room where they met. And the effect of this was immediate, as they went out onto the crowded streets of Jerusalem, crowded and full of foreign visitors who'd come for the Jewish festival of Pentecost. And as Peter and the others started speaking to those crowds, the Holy Spirit's help was quite obvious. Obvious, firstly, in the way he gave them courage. Now, they'd been pretty worried since Jesus' death, worried, fearful that they too might be arrested as Jesus had been. And so they very much kept themselves to themselves. But now, all of a sudden, they were out on the streets, speaking publicly and boldly about God, suddenly quite fearless. So he gave them courage, and then secondly, the Holy Spirit enabled their message to be communicated clearly. Each one of them heard the believers speaking in his own language. There were pilgrims from all over the world in Jerusalem for the festival, but the Holy Spirit miraculously enabled those foreign visitors to understand as the disciples spoke. The Holy Spirit enabled a miracle of communication so that the message got across clearly. And then a third thing, the Holy Spirit worked in the hearts of the listeners. That day, about 3,000 of them put their faith in the Lord Jesus. So the Holy Spirit giving courage to the believers, making communication possible, working in the hearts of listeners. Those events of the day of Pentecost were a very clear example of the Holy Spirit enabling the church in its mission. So enabling the church, and then secondly, the Holy Spirit guiding the church in its mission. And we see this time after time as we read through Acts. There's the time, for example, when the Holy Spirit tells Philip to go to the Ethiopian who's riding in his chariot and to answer that man's questions about the Messiah. There's the time when the Holy Spirit tells Peter to go with the men who'll lead him to Cornelius the centurion so that the gospel's taken to the Gentiles. It's such a vital moment in the story as a whole new mission field opens up, because this now isn't just about Jewish people discovering their long-promised Messiah. It's about the whole world encountering the Saviour of the world. And then there's the time in chapter 13 when the Holy Spirit tells the church at Antioch to set apart Paul and Barnabas for their special mission. And it's the Holy Spirit who then sends Paul and Barnabas on their way on that first missionary journey. Or there's the time on Paul's second missionary journey when the Holy Spirit steers Paul away from Asia and guides him in other directions. We would actually like to know a bit more. What form did the Holy Spirit's guidance take? How exactly did he guide Paul? Acts doesn't tell us, but it makes it very clear that guide him, he did. In all the missionary activity of the church, the Holy Spirit's there to guide them and direct them. Where should they go? Who should they speak to? What should they say? The Holy Spirit guided every part of their mission. So enabling, guiding, and then thirdly, the Holy Spirit surprising the church in the way he governs their mission. Now, I should imagine that the believers were all absolutely amazed on the day of Pentecost when they suddenly found themselves out there on the streets of Jerusalem preaching the gospel. But in Acts, it's clear on other occasions too that the church's mission took place in unexpected ways. It wasn't always a question of the church leaders working out very cleverly devised strategies. It was sometimes the Holy Spirit taking them down completely unexpected avenues. There was a lot of evangelistic activity, for example, which happened because of the persecution of the church in Jerusalem. When a wave of persecution broke out, the leaders of the church stayed in Jerusalem, but lots of the believers scattered. Now, you might think that a setback like that would spell the great difficulty for the church, perhaps even the end of the church. But instead, those believers who ran for it and ended up in all sorts of different places, they spoke about Jesus wherever it was that they ended up. And so in any number of towns and cities, people heard about Jesus and they became believers. Another huge amount of evangelism happened because of Paul. The second half of Acts is all about him and his work as a missionary. But this would never have been planned by the church. The person God chose and to whom the Holy Spirit gave many gifts, he was a violent opponent of the church. But Paul, he was converted, not through a member of the church, but by God's direct intervention. And he devoted the rest of his life to preaching the gospel to all and sundry wherever the Holy Spirit guided him to go. But he was the last person on earth that the church would have chosen. So those scattered believers and Paul, two examples of the Holy Spirit working in surprising ways, working in spite of setbacks, working through unlikely people. In neither case could the church have planned it. But when the church saw these things happening, they questioned, they investigated, so as to assure themselves that this really was God's doing. And then, once they were sure that it was, they were fully behind it and accepted it as part of their mission. It was an example of the principle which we've often reminded ourselves of: see where God's working and join in. The early church was surprised, to say the least, at God's choice of Paul, the former persecutor. But once they realized he was God's choice, they supported him all the way. So what about the church today in the 21st century? God's Holy Spirit enabling, guiding, and surprising the early church as it embarked on its mission to tell the people the good news of Jesus. That was the experience of the early church, but it's the experience of the church today too. We can expect him to enable us, as he gives us courage to speak to others about Jesus and about our faith in him, as he helps us to communicate clearly, and as he works in the hearts of the people to whom we speak or to whom we show God's love in practical ways, as he works in their hearts and draws them to himself. We can expect him to guide us as we think about how we can serve the people in our community and how we can make the good news of Jesus known, take that good news to every home in Ely. We can expect him to guide us individually about who we might pray for, that they'll come to know Jesus. And we can expect him to surprise us. We may be surprised at the courage we find. We can make plans as to how we'll do our mission, but we might be surprised as things don't go exactly to plan, but they do go well. And we can expect to be surprised by the people who respond. It may not be the people we were expecting. So then, the day of Pentecost, God's Holy Spirit coming to the church, God's power and God's presence coming to live in his people, and the Spirit involving himself in the church's mission, enabling, guiding, and surprising the church as he does so. And let me finish by highlighting one more verse from Acts. Chapter 2 ends by saying very simply, "The Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved." The Lord added to their number. This mission was his work. When Jesus left the earth, he didn't say, "Well, I've done my bit, I'm finished, now it's up to you to do your bit." And that could be the impression given by that legend with which I began. But no, he was saying, "My work continues, and I want you, helped by the Holy Spirit, to work with me. I want you, the church, my body, I want you to do this work of mine. I want you to be my hands, my feet, my lips." That's our task as we play our part in the Bible's continuing big story. Let's pray. Loving God, on the day of Pentecost, you gave to your church the gift of the Holy Spirit. Give us the help of the same Spirit in all our life and worship, that we may expect great things from you and attempt great things for you. Grant us boldness, increase our faith, and enlarge our love for the world you've made. Make us ever ready to serve you, that we may show to the world your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and so bring honour to you, our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Generations, forever and ever. Amen.